My dear friends in Christ, this night we are going to have a reflection from the scripture, and we are going to read Matthew chapter 15, verse 21 to 28. Thank you, Jesus. Matthew chapter 15, verse 21 to 28. And I am going to read from the New King James Version. The New King James Version. Then Jesus went out from there and they departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region, and they cried out to Jesus, saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed." But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and they urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she cries out after us." And he answered and said, "I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Then she came and worshipped him, saying, "Lord, help me." But he answered and said, "It is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs." And she said, "Yes, Lord. Yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered and said to her, "O woman, great is your faith. Let it be done to you as you desire." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. And this is the gospel of the Lord. My dear friends in Christ, this wonderful day, the Lord is talking to us on a very important subject, and that is the subject of faith. When we talk about faith, our mind usually go to Hebrews chapter 11, where faith was defined, and where the Bible took time to mention names of people of faith. But I want to discuss about a woman whose name was not listed in the Hebrews chapter 11, a woman who was not even a Jewish woman. This woman, as the Bible made us understand, is a woman of Canaan. Canaan was that region happened to be the Gentile region, people that are considered to be very unclean. The Jews consider them to be ritually unclean people. And so this woman came from that region. And this woman did something that made Jesus to say, you have a great faith. Oh woman, great is your faith. And we know that Jesus does not compromise words. He says it raw as it is. And so for Jesus to look at this woman, not minding that she was not even a Jewish woman, not minding that she was not in the household of Israel, and Jesus reminded her as so, telling her, look, that this I am not sent except to the house, lost sheep of the house of Israel. And so this did not prevent this woman from persevering in her faith. At the end, she got what she wanted. But what was actually this woman's problem? The problem was that this woman had a daughter that was seriously tormented by certain demon. The Bible didn't give us the name of that demon, but the scripture made it clear that this daughter was severely demon-possessed. So it was the demon that was afflicting the life of the daughter. And this gave a concern to the mother. And the mother could not sleep. The mother lost appetite. The mother lost peace in her life, wondering what would make my daughter to be well. I mean, we know how we feel when our children are sick, when our children are not doing well. We feel concerned. We try to see ways to solve their problem. And we go extra mile even to make sure that we do what we're supposed to do as, you know, parents, to make sure that their situation is arrested. And even if you don't have what it takes, sometimes we even go and borrow money if it is an issue of money, or even go to somebody's house we're not supposed to go to, and they say, please help me. There is not, a lot of time, situations make people go to where they're not supposed to go. Now, in this case, this woman, a Canaanite woman, a woman from the Gentile region, she came from the class of people considered by the Jews to be unclean. And in other words, let me tell you something. There is no reason why that woman would even go and talk to a Jew. They don't even talk to themselves. You see, the Jewish people and Gentiles, they are completely people that don't unite together. They don't agree together. Okay? Now, this woman was not even supposed to go and talk to Jesus to start with. But you know what? Situation came to her so terribly that after hearing what Jesus was doing, the wonders that were taking place in the life of Jesus, and how Jesus miraculously had, you know, raised people from the death, and so many things happened, and news about Jesus was just everywhere. And this woman had to go to Jesus. She had just had to go to Jesus. And that was the reading we had today. Before I get into further about this message tonight, I would like to let you know something very important. In the Bible, in the scripture, there are only two places. In fact, I'm referring to the Gospels, that's the New Testament. There are only two places in the Gospel that the word great faith was used. You know, only two people were commended as having great faith, you know, by Jesus. One was the centurion who tells Jesus, Lord, only say the word and my servant will be healed. That was the statement of the man called centurion. Jesus was pleased with the faith in that man. Jesus saw the faith in that man. Remember that the centurion whose servant was so sick had to send one of his servants to go and meet Jesus and tell Jesus to come to his house. On a second thought, he said, oh, I'm not worthy that he may come to my roof. So he himself now ran after the servant. Unfortunately, the servant was already with Jesus. And then he now went, met Jesus and said, I'm not worthy that you may come to my house, but only say your word, only speak the word, and my servant shall be healed. I am also a man of authority. I mean, when Jesus was listening to this man talk, saying, I am a man of authority, I tell them to go, they go. I tell them to stop, they stop. I tell them to sit down, they sit down. They obey me. If you say the word, my servant shall be healed. Jesus saw a wonderful faith. He said, I've never seen this kind of faith, even in Israel. So the Lord Jesus expected this kind of wonderful faith in the man in Israel. But unfortunately, this man was not even a Jewish man. You see the point now? He wasn't even a Jewish. Mm-hmm. We see this in Matthew chapter 8, verse 8, where this man said, Lord, only say the word, and my servant shall be healed. Who taught this man? Who told him? Who educated him that Jesus, when Jesus speaks his word, that settles the matter? Psalm 107, verse 20 says, he spoke his word, and he healed all of them. All of them. Acts 10, verse 30 says, Jesus filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, going about doing good, healing those who were sick. So this man, not matter he was not a Jewish man, yet he knew about the ministry of Jesus, the ministry of healing, of deliverance, the ministry to set people free, to bring freedom into the destiny of people. No wonder John Evertazi says, and indeed the Son of Man shall set you free, and whosoever he sets free shall be free indeed. Yes, that man of Calvary is the one we're talking about. And he saw the faith in this man, in this gentleman, and the matter was settled, for even the servant was healed because Jesus spoke so. My dear friends in Christ, the other woman or the other person in the scripture that Jesus said, great is your faith, happened to be this Canaanite woman. Remember, the first one was that man, the centurion. The second one happened to be the Canaanite woman. Jesus was pleased with her faith. In the case of the Canaanite woman, she didn't give up, in spite of the fact that Jesus told her things that would discourage her, things that would make her to give up. But this was a way of Jesus testing her faith. But this woman passed the exam. And I tell you, even the situations we pass in life, these are all moments of testing our faith. You are supposed to do well in that exam. You have taught people in that course. Everybody knew you knew it very well. But then you went to the exam, you didn't make it. You second time didn't make it. And you keep wondering, what have I done? What is wrong? What am I supposed to do that I've not done? I want to tell you, perhaps God is testing your faith. And when we pass the test, oh, how great and how comforting, how encouraging is the word of the Lord that says, great is your faith. I cannot wait to hear that voice, that word from Jesus. And I do want to let you know, when this woman persisted, you know, in her faith, you know, when this woman didn't give up, the result was that it paid off. And her daughter was now healed, as Matthew chapter 15, verse 28 made us understand. Now, Jesus told her, great is your faith. What is very, very outstanding and yet common between these two people that Jesus said in the gospel, that great is your faith? What is very unique, what is very common to two of them, happened to be that these two were not even Jewish people. The centurion and the Gentile woman, the Canaanite woman, they were not Jewish people. They came from the class of people that were considered unclean. And we see the power of Jesus. He extended his generosity. He extended his love to them. Yes, he showed them the healing that he has been showing to the people of Israel. That God is a God who is no he's no respecter of any person. Yes, Lord. Where there is division, he wants to mess up the plan of the enemy to put division in families or in ethnic groups, and he wants them to be one. That God is here today. In my dear friends in Christ, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, the Bible says, for he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups to be one, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility between them. And I tell you, maybe your family, this message I'll be talking about to you, maybe there is a Gentile and there is a Jewish in your family. Maybe your husband is not talking with you, or maybe you're not talking with your certain relatives because of certain things that has resulted in that situation. That is just like the Jewish people and the Gentile. They don't talk. They don't even, do you know that even if a Gentile is thirsty, he cannot even go to the well of an Israeli to go and drink water. It was as bad as that. But I tell you, Jesus Christ now came to destroy the dividing wall. Remember that when he was on the cross and he gave up to the ghost, the Bible said there was an earthquake. The whole earth shook. Also, the Bible made me to understand that the sun gave up its light and there was darkness all over the world, as if to say, oh, the light of the world is gone. Let me pay my homage or my respect to him. But there was another thing that happened in the temple, and that was the temple veil, the temple curtain was torn into two on his own accord. Mark 15, verse 38 says, and the temple veil was torn into two from top to bottom. From today, Jesus Christ is still tearing that temple veil into two. He is still tearing the dividing wall into two. He is still lobbying, bringing us together, to reason together to be one. And that God, who though came from the Jewish community, has extended the water of healing even unto those that are not deserving of it. And I tell you, we don't even deserve God's mercy. Those things we get from the Lord, we don't even deserve them. We don't even deserve those blessings. But God, out of grace, gives them to us. So it's out of grace that even this Canaanite woman received blessing from the Lord. It was out of grace that the centurion received something from the Lord, healing from the Lord. And it is by the same grace that will function. No wonder our brother Paul was struggling with an issue in his life. And he said, Lord, I have tried to take away this stone from my flesh, but it has always been there. And Paul, the Lord told him, Lord, it is my grace. My grace is sufficient for you. We live by God's grace. And that's why even at the beginning of this prayer, we started by even calling on the Lord to dispense his grace upon each and every one of us. My dear friends in Christ, our God wants to do in our lives and families, in our destinies, in our society, the same thing he did to the Canaanite woman. Do you still remember the story of John chapter number 4, where Jesus met the woman at the well? You see that story from John chapter 4, verse 13, 14, and 15. And Jesus said, give me water to drink. I don't know, was wondering, how could a Jewish man come and ask a Gentile to give him water? I mean, it was something strange to her. But you know what? This is a way of Jesus passing a message to break the wall of division. I'm not going to talk this night on breaking the wall of division, but I do want to let us know that Jesus wants to do in our lives that same thing he did in the life of this Canaanite woman. My dear friends in Christ, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 15, verse 21, that on this particular occasion, Jesus ministered outside of the Jewish territory. Sidon and Tyre happened to be outside the Jewish territory. In fact, in today's geography, the Sidon and the Tyre exist somewhere around the modern-day Lebanon. So this was not the territory of the Jews. And it was when Jesus made that trip to that unlikely place that this Gentile woman, a foreigner, who was not considered a Jewish, woman, met Jesus. And they asked Jesus for a help. You see, one thing I want to let you know is that while many of us think that it's only when you go to the church or the synagogue or the house of prayer, like Hannah crying to the Lord in the synagogue, that God will hear us. I want to tell you that God goes extra mile even to come and bless his people, even to come and visit them at unlikely places. Jesus left the territory of the Jews, a place considered to be his own territory, and he crossed the border. He went into the other territory. I am praying maybe your own territory, maybe the territory of your family or your loved ones is a territory considered to be people who don't have time for God. Maybe the life that they are living is a life that is not Christian life, just like the Gentiles. My prayer tonight is that it may please our Lord Jesus Christ, who went to Tyre and Sidon into that very territory of the Gentiles. May he cross that border tonight. May he visit those people, even where they are having their drinking club. May he go there and touch their hearts. I know that Jesus, even in the life of Matthew, he crossed the border into the border of a tax collector. And as Jesus was leaving that office, as he was just passing by, as he was leaving there, Matthew was never the same person again. He changed because he met the life changer. He changed because the one that changes life encounter touches life. He met Jesus. I am praying right now that anywhere there is a cohort of the evil ones, anywhere that the evil ones are fellowshipping, I am praying that Jesus will send his feet there. May his footprints touch those places. I know that as he goes there, new things will happen in the name of Jesus. Maybe your husband has been a drunkard, and after work, you don't see him in the house till late night. Where has he gone? He's only finding company and joy, fellowshipping with drunkards, drinking and drinking until he himself will become drunken. I want to tell you, don't fight it yourself. You cannot fight it. The Bible made me to understand in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 9, that by strength shall no man prevail. My prayer tonight is that even in that their club, even in that their territory, even in that their place of fellowship, where they drink and drink, I pray that Jesus will cross border and enter there. When Jesus enters there, the situation will change. How do I know? Because he is the one that changes situations. When he enters into any situation, even if he's in a graveyard, life will come out from the graveyard. Have you forgotten John chapter 11, verse 38? And Jesus said, show me where he was buried. And in the moment they showed him where Lazarus was buried, and Jesus came to the grave site. And I tell you, my dear brothers and sisters, the Bible made me to understand that in John chapter 11, verse 43, Jesus spoke out in a loud voice. And he said, oh, he said, come out, Lazarus. And the power of death, the power of darkness could not contend with Jesus. How could they contend with Jesus? How could they contend with him? The one whose word calmed the storm. How could they contend with him? The one that in whose name the every knee bows, even Satan bows. How can they contend with the authority of Jesus? My dear friends in Christ, in John chapter 11, verse 44, life came into Lazarus, and then Jesus said, untie him and let him go. In other words, he went into the grave, and the life came into the life of Lazarus, a dead man, a man who was already dead for 4 days. You see, let me tell you, even when Jesus came there and was telling the people in John chapter 11, 39, to take away the stone, to roll away the stone, Martha told Jesus in the same John 11, 39, said, Lord, by this time he's already smelling. Ah! Oh! Jesus! But Jesus had to correct him. He said, look, let me tell you, Martha, if you believe, you shall see the glory of God. The message I'm having for Sunday tonight is that if you believe, Jesus will cross into your territory. He will cross into your Gentile region. He will cross into that unlikely place in your life. And he is coming there to change your situation. That is the message I have for you. When he came into the gravesite of Lazarus, where Lazarus was buried, oh my, Arubo Shinderebo, the Bible made me to understand that Lazarus came back to life. Lazarus came back to life. Death vomited what he swallowed because Jesus came in, because he entered into the territory. That is why I'm saying that if you will call on him and say, Lord, enter into my territory, I know that he is not going to leave you the same. He cannot leave you the same. In the life of the Gentile woman, Jesus did not go there under the invitation of this woman. Jesus went into her territory. But you know what? This woman took advantage and they keyed into the anointing from the Lord Jesus. And her case was settled. She was established. She was established. Ha! I said she was established. No wonder the Bible makes it clear that those who put their trust in the Lord, they will not be put to shame. Do you think you have been put to shame? I am praying that Almighty God, the shame eraser, may He visit you. May He change every ugly clock of the devil in your life. Whatever thing that is happening in your life that is under the influence and the scheme of the enemies, I am praying that the Almighty God will paralyze those networks in the name of Jesus. And so when Jesus came to the gravesite, situation changed. When Jesus came into the region of Tyre and Sidon, situation changed. Anywhere you find Jesus going to, situation will change. Even when Jesus went into the life and the family of the man called Jairus, okay, when the daughter was sick and eventually died, do you know that the moment Jesus came to the house, that daughter who was sick before the father left the house to go and call on Jesus, died, and people were weeping. And Jesus said, she's sleeping. You know what people say? People laughed at him and said, are you trying to tell us that we don't know when somebody's dead? But Jesus proved them wrong when he said, daughter, wake up. Daughter, stand up. And the dead child came back to life. The moment Jesus had his feet in that territory, life came in. Mm-hmm. The family was not happy. The shame was taken away. They were established. You see, I want to tell you something. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20, the Bible made me to understand, believe in the Lord your God, so you shall be established. Believe his prophets, and you shall prosper. You see, this is a very strong statement. That if I believe in the Lord, my God, if I believe in Jesus, that I shall be established. And so I am praying at this hour for you. And I'm inviting you to join me in this prayer. To ask the Almighty God to visit my situation. Ask Him to visit your situation. Let Him enter into your territory. No matter how bad it is, even if it is a smelling situation, your situation will be so bad that it is a foregone conclusion. When something is defined as a foregone conclusion, it means that it is a bygone. It's a concluded chapter. But I want to let you know something. It is not over until Jesus says it is over. Death said it was over for Lazarus. I could imagine Mr. Death crossing leg and drinking and thinking of 100 people to go and kill. For John 10, verse 10 says he came to kill, to destroy, and to take away. But when Jesus came to the gravesite, when the feet of Jesus came into that gravesite, the situation changed. Life came in into the dead man. The man that was smelling could not smell death again. Even when Jesus came there and wanted to do this miracle, Martha said, by this time he's already stinking. He's already an odor. He's already a stench. But I tell you, Jesus proved Martha wrong. And maybe you think that marriage is a stench, or maybe you think that relationship between you and that your husband is a stench, or that what is happening in your career is a stench. You think that you have done everything you're supposed to do, but there's a stench. I am calling on the Almighty God, the King of Kings. Let Him step His feet into your territory. Let Him step His feet into your destiny. May it please Him through the prayer to come and lift you up from that mess. When Lazarus was lying in the grave, Jesus came in and lifted him up. Jesus came in and delivered him in the name of Jesus. When Jesus stepped into the Tyre and Sidon territory, life came into the daughter of the woman of the Canaanite. I don't know what is the demon that is oppressing your own child. I don't know the spirit that is manipulating your children. I am calling on Jesus for you at this hour. May he step into your family. Papa, step into their family. Papa, step into our families. Families where children are misbehaving. Father, we know this was not the way they were meant to be behaving. We understand that this is an arrow of affliction. Father, this is a scheme to mess up the minds, the peace of the parents. But Father, we are praying that these children be delivered, O God. Papa, deliver them, O God. Step into my family and touch my life. Step into my family as you step into the territory of the Gentiles. Papa, step into my family in the name of Jesus. Every Gentile in my family, Papa, take them away tonight. Every Gentile spirit in my family, Papa, take them away tonight. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, begin to call on the Lord now. Begin to call on him now. Let the fire of Jesus, let him deliver my children. Let him deliver my husband. Let him deliver my wife. In the name of Jesus. Begin to pray right now. When Jesus came to the territory of the people of Canaan, the Gentile region, the Bible understands that this woman whose daughter was demon-possessed on him, because Jesus is the key to the solution. He has the key to that problem. No matter the problem you have, Jesus is more than able to handle it. In the name of Jesus, for every problem, there is a key to solve it. Jesus is that key. Oh my, in the name of Jesus. Oh Jesus, we are calling on him now. May his power begin to flow. Papa, touch your people. Holy Father, we need you. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Papa, the hour has come. Papa, the hour has come. Move into my family. Come and touch my people. Come and touch my people. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Papa, touch me, Lord. Holy Father, touch me, Lord. I need a touch of the Master. I need a touch of the Master. Let your power touch me. Let your power touch me. Begin to pray now. Begin to pray now, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. My people, pray now. Every spirit that is against my life, pulling down my family, let them be destroyed, because Jesus is coming in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Every spirit, evil spirits, demonic spirits, unclean spirits, that have invaded my life, in the name of Jesus, come out and go to that beast now. Yes, my Lord. My people, pray now. Begin to pray now. The power of God is moving, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Yes, Lord. Jesus. Oh, the Gentiles were people considered unclean. And no wonder the daughter of this woman was not possessed by unclean spirit. But when Jesus came in, that was over. She got delivered. I am going to pray for people whose daughters, whose sons are possessed by any spirit, whatsoever the name may be. Since I was on tears yesterday, telling me, brother, pray for my daughter who has become a lesbian. This is a spirit. It's a demon spirit. You see that? And when you see a man, you just make himself to be a woman. They say he's transgender. I don't know how to describe this again. This is a
a school of demon, giving people ideas of something, doing things unthinkable. Pornographic life. These are things that the devil is projecting from the pit of hell. A lot of things happen. Sometimes I wish you hear the things I hear. Then you understand the need for prayer. I was talking with a lady the other day. I told her, brother, I don't know. Please pray for me. I'm in a mess. When sometimes certain spirits will come, and before I know what's happening, I will sleep with four men I've never met in my life before. Can you imagine that? If you're not hearing from me now, could you even imagine that? Men she never met before. So we are praying now. Every spirit that has possessed any of our children, pornographic spirits, whatever is their name, that is in the life of any child. Hey! Makandaya Boshirebu, let the fire of Jesus melt all such spirits now. Let him destroy them. Yes, Lord, this is a time of warfare. Begin to pray now. Begin to pray now. Begin to pray for your children. Begin to pray for them. Mm-hmm. Begin to pray for them. Every spirit causing stubbornness in them, may God who delivered the daughter of this Canaanite woman, may he also deliver your children. Begin to talk to him now. Ask him to deliver them. Ask him to deliver them. In the name of Jesus, every spirit that is causing my child to be taking drugs, to be taking weed, to be fellowshipping with drunkards, to be going out to wrong people in life, to be sleeping about, to be into illicit relationships, to hate prayer, I am calling upon Jesus, step into my family. Step into my family. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Open your mouth and pray that prayer. Yes, Lord. Father Almighty, step into my family. Step into my children. Father, deliver them. Father, deliver them. Papa, deliver them. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. All the children that are under demonic attacks, having nightmare in the spirit, may God deliver them now. Holy Father, deliver them. Deliver them from the spirit of nightmare. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Those that are possessed by the spirit, husbands, by the spirit, wives, oh, Makanda Yarabo Shekerebo, Reke Mashakanda Rabo, Reke Murobo Shiribo, every spirit husband in them. I command you now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get it to come out, come out, come out in the name of Jesus, come out, and go to the rubbish. Mm-hmm. Yes, Lord, the fire is moving now, the fire is moving now, Jesus is stepping into the family. Ah! Jesus, you crocodile spirit, you crocodile spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom I serve, I rebuke you, I rebuke you, I rebuke you, come out, come out and go to rubbish, come out, in the name of Jesus, yes Lord, don't take this prayer lightly, everybody should be in prayer, something's happening already, Jesus. Jesus, the fire is moving. The fire is moving. Yes, my Lord. The power of God is moving. He touching people. He touching people. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, spirit of drunkenness, I command you now. Come out of my husband. Come out of my wife. Come out of my children. In the name of Jesus, every spirit that wants to mess up my family, spirit that is causing lie, I cancel them now. I'm a sherry, bo. Let us be destroyed because Jesus is coming to my family. Because he's coming to my family in the name of Jesus. As he steps into my family, hey, he is coming to deliver me. As he steps into my family, he will change the ugly situations in the family in the name of Jesus. As he steps into my destiny, he is going to transform my destiny in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. As he stepped into the grave site of Lazarus and brought back Lazarus to life. So I am praying now. People that, families that their prayer life is dead. that their destinies are buried. There are people that their destinies are buried, just like Lazarus was buried. But Jesus stepped into that very gravesite, and the buried man came out. So I am praying for you now that whosoever that his or her destiny is buried, I am praying for you now. It is time to come out. It is time to come out in the name of Jesus. Jesus. Oh, yeah, begin to pray now. Begin to pray now. I will not remain this way. My system will change. My Lord Jesus, do in my family what you did in the life of Lazarus. In the name of Jesus. Papa, come and do it in my family. I just need a visit of yours. I just need your footprint. Your footprint in my family. Your footprint in my career. Your footprint in my destiny. In the name of Jesus. Begin to pray now. Yes, my Lord. Pray. Hey, don't get tired. Jesus, the power of God is moving. In the name of Jesus. My people, pray now. You can pray better than that. You can change the frequency of that prayer. Hey, Mashikeribo, the power of God is moving. He has come to my territory. He has come to my family. He has come to me to come and take away my shame, to come and take away my odor. Every odor in my family, every smell in my family, let them be removed now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, every spirit of autism in my children. What are you waiting for? Have you not heard that Jesus has come to my family? That Jesus is coming to my family. He is already at the door. He is entering my family. In the name of Jesus. Therefore, you unclean spirit, you Gentile spirit, you spirit of autism, I command you now. In the name of Jesus, begin to come out now. Pack your luggage and go. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. My people, begin to pray. Begin to mention every disease, every sickness in the family. Now is the time for healing. Because Jesus has entered the family. This is the time for healing. The same man of Calvary who entered into Sidon and entered into Tyre, he is coming to your family now. Talk to him now. Yes, my Lord. He will settle your case. Begin to mention those problems. Begin to mention that sickness. What is troubling you? The fire of God is moving. He's touching you now. He's touching the children. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. My people pray now. Yes, my Lord. Every spirit that is keeping the children busy with pornography, I cancel it now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Every spirit keeping them busy with the life of evil, with wicked life, I cancel now. With the life of error, I cancel now. With the spirit of weeds, I cancel now. In the name of Jesus. Begin to pray now. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, as you call on him, he will answer you. I know him as a man who answers prayers. Call on him now. He has a covenant with you, a covenant to deliver you, to deliver your family. Begin to pray now. Call on him. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, pray. The power of God is moving. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, every power stopping my pregnancy, I cancel now. In the name of Jesus. Under this visitation of Jesus, in this August, in this month, may I be delivered as a Jesus. Because my August visitor, my situation will change. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Papa, come and take over. Daddy, come and take over. Operation, take over. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, let your hand break every evil hand in my family. In the name of Jesus. My people, pray now. I say, pray, my people. Oh, Jesus, the power of God is moving. Yes, my Lord. Come and answer me. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, who will deliver me? If not you, Papa, come and deliver me. In the name of Jesus. Ha ha! Woo!
Jesus.
Every ancestral spirit, anywhere they are, as Jesus is stepping into my family, let the yoke of ancestral spirits begin to melt. Begin to melt. Begin to melt. Ah, Jesus, I am calling upon the angels of God. Let them go into your land of nativity and harvest the soil, the earth from your land, and bring it into this prayer. And use this prayer to break every curse in the land, in the soil, in the earth, in the name of Jesus. Everything that is flowing you about through this vision of Jesus into your family, let such ancestral chains be broken. Be broken. Be broken. Be broken. Break, 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 break. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Oh, my dear people of God, this Gentile woman had an encounter with Jesus. She heard about Jesus. And she met Jesus. And on the spot, she started to plead for help. As if she knew that her help would come from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Psalm 124 verse 8. At the first time, Jesus seemed to pay no attention to her. And this made his disciples to feel embarrassed. Jesus does test, he did this to test the woman to awaken faith in her. Sometimes you are asking God for something and God is silent. You don't know that he is, by that silence, trying to take your faith to another level. If you ask God just something once and he gives it to you, I pray for that it happens. But if you keep doing it that way, how will your faith be growing? How will your faith be strong? All this while, Abraham kept asking God for children. But God didn't answer him. I mean, God answered him, but he didn't manifest that time. Sometimes the same thing happens to us. And so was the faith of Abraham growing with age. Growing as he kept asking God for intervention. So when Jesus kept silent to this woman, it was to pull out the best in her. It was to stimulate, to activate her faith. So if God seems not to be answering you, and you know you are doing everything you're supposed to do as a child of God, and you are praying like Sarah or like Hannah, and the situation has not changed, perhaps God is trying to take your faith on a level. The moment the faith of this woman grew up, Jesus said, that's what I'm looking for. And the miracle took place. There is great power in faith. Permit me to tell you that there is something that moves God, and that is faith. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6 says that you cannot please God without faith. Can you imagine that? So even when you think you want to please God by building a cathedral, that's good. But God didn't say you will please him by doing something extraordinary. It is something as simple as having faith. And this Gentile woman was the one who is now the teacher tonight, teaching us, the children of the kingdom, how to show faith, how to have faith in Jesus. So why did Jesus mean, what did Jesus mean by the expression throwing bread to the dogs? Remember that this was what Jesus told this woman. Ah. The first time this woman made her request to Jesus, the Bible says in Matthew 15, verse 23, and Jesus did not even answer her. Jesus did not even give a word. Silence. The disciples watched the matter and told Jesus, listen, her way. She's disturbing us. Maybe that place you are praying, people are saying you are disturbing them. May God answer you in the name of Jesus. And then Jesus now answered her by telling her something that will break somebody's heart. I was not sent except for the lordship of the house of Israel. Can you see that? This woman, instead of giving up, said, you know what she did? The Bible says she now started worshiping Jesus. Matthew 15, verse 25. Then she came and worshiped him. Are you not learning something from there? I was not sent to you to hear you. That was Anna was saying it. I was not sent for the Gentiles. I was sent for the household of Israel. And instead of this woman turning back, leaving Jesus, this woman has started worshiping Jesus, doing what the Jews could not even do. It was the Jews that crucified Jesus. It was the Jews in John 18, verse 38, that asked Jesus, what is the truth? Even when the truth was standing before him or before them. And this Gentile woman knew that Jesus is the truth and started worshiping him instead of leaving Jesus. Sometimes we ask Jesus for something, he didn't answer us, or do we want it, or sometimes he keeps just his silence. Some people, they walk away. But this woman, a Gentile woman, somebody who doesn't even know about the living God, is telling us today that even when that happens, that she went to her knees and started worshiping him. At that point, Jesus now told her the thing that was even worse than the first one. The first one was that, look, I was sent only to the household of the lordship of the house of Israel. Now, Jesus now told her, it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. Aha! Do you know what that means? Throwing bread to the little dogs. The Jews often spoke of the Gentiles with arrogance and their insolence as unclean dogs. Of course, dog is an unclean animal. And they categorize them as unclean dogs because Gentiles, they don't follow God's law. And they were excluded from God's covenant and favor with the people of Israel. So for the Greeks, the word dog was a symbol of dishonor and was used to describe a shameless and audacious woman. This is another reference to dogs in Matthew's gospel, where Jesus says to his disciples, do not give to dogs what is holy. Remember when Jesus said that kind of thing? Find that in Matthew 7, verse 6. You do not give to dogs what is holy. So you see the symbolism of dog in the culture we're talking about. Jesus now tested this woman's faith to see if she is earnest in receiving holy things from the hand of the holy God. And Jesus had to use the worst of the words, and that is dog. Jesus, no doubt, spoke with a smile, rather. I wasn't there, but because I know the man of Calvary, he smiles a lot, he loves everyone. He could have been smiling when saying those to this woman, but this woman did not even back out. You know what she said? Even the dogs eat the crumbs. At that point, Jesus said, no. This faith is too much. And he healed the daughter. Jesus So put yourself in the shoes of this woman. Because she was a woman as well as a Canaanite, a Gentile. This desperate mother had two striking situations against her. One, a woman, you know, of course, in the Jewish culture, in the culture of those people, being a woman was already automatically a second class. You don't think I have to say. And now, in spite of that, she's now a Gentile. Hey! So how could a Gentile even come close to Jesus? So these were the two odds against her. And because she was desperate for the deliverance of her child, she had to break the odds. She had to pass boundary. I am praying that the prayer of this night motivates you, prepares you to cross border, to do something extraordinary that will get the attention of heaven. Jesus, out of love for her daughter, and with the faith in Jesus and in the power of Jesus to heal, this woman kept persevering in her faith. She didn't want to go home with that handicap. She wanted to get healed. I am praying for somebody tonight. As you have come to this prayer line with your own handicap, with whatever handicap you have, oh, may Jesus use this message to change that situation. May Jesus use this message to wipe your tears. May that handicap disappear. May that handicap disappear. May that handicap in the name of Jesus disappear. For the Bible made me to understand the handicap of the daughter in the daughter of the Canaanite woman disappeared because of Jesus. So because of Jesus, I will not continue my life with this handicap. I refuse to be a handicap in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. This situation in my life must melt under the fire of Jesus in the name of Jesus. Jesus. So she began by addressing Jesus in Jewish way of, you know, addressing the Lord. Yeah, he said, you know what? He said, Son of David. Gentiles don't know what the Son of David. They don't even use it. They don't know it. But this woman said, Son of David. A Jewish term of faith. And she didn't stop there. She said, Lord, Son of David. The Jewish will go and worship their demons. All those things, status of their different gods. They don't address him as God, Lord or Son of David. But this woman used these nomenclatures. Jesus, I am praying that we shall be like this woman, persevering in faith, never giving up, never taking a no for an answer. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. So receiving rebuff from Jesus was not enough to make this woman to give up. She cleverly and humbly acknowledged Jesus' word by boldly pointing out that even the alien, even the dogs, all right, can eat the crumbs that fall from the table, can eat from the ministry of Jesus. And Jesus commended her faith. I said, woman, you have great faith. Not that she had faith. She had great faith. There is faith, and there is great faith. You remember that Jesus was telling us, if you have a little faith, we can command even the mountain to move. Mountain will move. But now this woman had even more than the small faith to move the mountain. She had a great faith. And she left with her daughter healed. So, there are two key aspects in this woman's great faith. First, she was humble. Humility is very good to get. If you don't have humility in your life, God will despise you, because God despises the prayers of the pride. Remember, she was humble.
You know? Secondly, she was persistent. When humility meets persistence, the result is miracle. Jesus. Hey, may God touch your life in the name of Jesus. Whatever is obstacles, may God remove them in the name of Jesus. As this Gentile woman came from the unclean territory and came to clean territory, to the man that makes people clean, and she was made clean. So, under the invitation of the Holy Spirit, may we go to Jesus to make us clean in the name of Jesus. May we become people of prayer in the name of Jesus. May we join the Gentile woman to say, Jesus, my Lord, O Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus. If you have a need that calls for intercession, let this woman's humility and persistence teach you how to approach Jesus. I am praying for humility and persistence in our prayer life. Open your mouth and pray that prayer. Lord, make me humble in the name of Jesus. Father, help me to have a humble spirit. Yes, my Lord. Remove every pride in me, every stony heart in me, every spirit that makes it difficult for me to yield. Father, take them away from me. Father, help me, Lord, to persevere in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, Papa, strengthen my faith. Strengthen my faith. Strengthen my faith. Ask him to strengthen your faith now. It's very important. Ask the Lord to strengthen your faith. Lord, strengthen my faith. Let my faith grow. Let my faith grow. Yes, let my faith grow. Father, let my faith grow to the point that you see in me as a man of faith, as a woman of faith. Yes, Lord. Jesus. Yes, Lord. Pray, my people. Yes, Lord. Begin to pray now. Say, Lord, draw me closer to you. Draw me closer to you. Let me tell you, this Gentile woman came close to Jesus and now knelt before Jesus and said, Lord, God Almighty. She said, oh, the Son of David, Lord, have mercy on me. She came very close. She was kneeling down, prostrate and worshiping him. The Bible said that she worshiped him. She started to worship Jesus. Even when Jesus told her, look, that he came for the household of Israel and not for the lost, not for the Gentiles. Yet this woman didn't give up. She now went on her knees and went to another level, and that's the level of worship. When you start worshiping, I tell you, something will happen. When you start worshiping, when that problem gets strong, gets very, very stubborn, when that situation is becoming prevalent and it becoming stubborn, I want you to get into the level of worship. You start worshiping God. This will start happening. Heaven will open when you start worshiping God. Hey, Jesus, have you not heard the Bible say that the Lord dwells in the praise of his people? Yes, and the Bible also says the Lord is the fearful in praises. When you start praising him, you will see him graduate into a man of fire. Hebrews 12:29 says, and our God is a consuming fire. Maybe he is at the level of mildness before you now, but the moment you go on your knees, the moment you start worshiping him, you close the door, you lock up everywhere, you switch up your phone, then you mean business. You start praising him and say, Lord, to you be all the glory, all the majesty, all the adoration. You begin to praise him. You join David in Psalm 103 verse 1 to say, Lord, I bless your holy name. I bless your Lord. I bless, I worship you. You say, bless the Lord, all my soul and all my innermost being blesses you. When you start to do that, you start praising him. Say, Lord, I praise you. You are the King of kings. You are the Lord of lords. As you start doing that, I tell you, something begins to happen. Miracles will begin to precipitate. Great things will begin to happen. Hey, Jesus, I am praying that through this prayer that somebody will tap into the resources of God, that somebody will be a man of prayer, will be somebody of fire, that you will become somebody who knows how to tap into the resources of the divinity. In the name of Jesus, through praises you can do that. That God is here. In the name of Jesus, as we praise him, hey, Jesus, great things shall happen. You praise him, you praise him.
You think that is the word of God, that he is a mighty man in battle, that he is the ancient of days. Revelation chapter 1 verse 8 says that he is the beginning, he is the end, he is the alpha, he is the omega, he is the first, he is the last. By the time you start praising him, start telling him those things, I tell you that God will get up from that seat and he will start doing something. The Bible maybe to understand that those who put their trust in the Lord, oh, they shall be put to shame. As you begin to praise him, as you begin to worship him, as you begin to glorify him, hey, things will begin to happen. Great things will begin to happen. In the name of Jesus. Holy Masheribo. Jesus. Even when Peter was praising him in the prison, the Bible to understand that the door, the prison door opened on his own. Maybe the reason why you are staying in that prison of sickness, in that prison of life, is because you have not gotten to the level to start to praise him in that situation. If you praise him in that situation, like this Canaanite woman, like this Gentile woman, I tell you, the power of God will move. The hand of God will move. Oh, Jesus! The moment the people of Israel, under the leadership of Joshua, said to praise him, and they blew a trumpet, and the wall of Jericho set to fall, I am praying that that God will visit you in the name of Jesus. That God will teach all the power of praises. May God be glorified. Papa, we praise you tonight. In the name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Jesus. Come and have your way, Papa. Who can do these things if not you? Who can change our ugly situations if not you? Jesus. Come and do a new thing, Lord. Teach us, Lord, always to approach you with the humble and persistent faith. Father, where else can we go if not to you? Have mercy on us, as you had mercy on this Canaanite woman. May we seek you, Lord, with expectant faith. May our faith never dwindle. May our faith never drown. Jesus. Peter's faith was strong, and he was walking on the sea. But the moment his faith started to dwindle, he started to sink. Papa, may we walk on the sea with great faith. May our faith never dwindle so that we do not sink. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Father. Thank you, mighty God, that this night your love and mercy shows no bounds, that you have visited your people and have blessed your people. Father, we trust in you. Blessed be your name, O God. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Father. Thank you, Jesus. And the Bible says, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Cover this message, word of Jesus, in Jesus' name. Amen.